Good morning to all of you. Now we are going to talk about the remaining concepts of this chapter. Now efficient concept is the efficient forward chaining. The forward chaining algorithm in figure 9.3 is designed for ease of understanding rather than efficiency of operation. So here we are to concentrate on the understanding rather than the efficiency. There are three important possible sources of inefficiency. First, that is inner loop of the algorithm involves finding all possible unifiers such that the premise of the rule unifies with a suitable set of facts in the knowledge base. This is often called pattern matching and can be very expensive. Second thing is that the algorithm rechecks every rule on every iteration to see whether its premise are satisfied even if every few additions are made to the knowledge base on each iteration. Finally, the algorithm might generate many facts that are relevant to the goal. We address each of these issues in turn. Now, the matching rules against known facts. The problem of matching the premises of a rule against the fact in the knowledge base might seem simple enough. For example, suppose you want to apply the rule like this, weapon of X implies weapon X. Then we need to find all the facts that unify with missile X in a suitably indexed knowledge base. This can be done in a constant time per fact. So this will be the equation where we are going to generate the formulas. Again, we can find all the objects owned by nano in constant time per object. Then for each object, we could check whether it is a missile. If the knowledge base contains many objects owned by nano and very few missiles, however, it would be better to find all the missiles first, then check whether they are owned by nano. This is conjunct ordering problem. Find an ordering to solve the conjunct of the rule premise so that the total cost is minimized. It turns out that finding the optimal ordering is NP hard, but good heuristic are available. So this will be the dynamic representation of the previous problem. The problem was a map coloring, which was seen previously. So this can be analyzed in a different way also. It seems rather depressing that forward chaining has an NP hard matching problem in its inner loop. There are three ways to cheer ourselves up. One, that is by using a data complexity. Now, we can remind ourselves that most rules in real-world knowledge bases are small and simple. It's common in the database world to assume that both the sizes of rules and arities predicates are bounded by constant to worry about the data complexity. We consider subclasses of rules for matching. Matching is efficient. Essentially, every data log clause can be viewed as defining a CSP. Now the next point is incremental forward chaining. When we showed how forward chaining works on the CRAM example, we stated particularly we omitted some of the rules matching done by the algorithm. Matching against missile M1, and of course the conclusion will be weapon M1, is already known, so nothing happens. Such redundant rule matching can be avoided if we make the following observation. In every observation, every new fact inferred an iteration T must be derived from at least one new fact inferred on iteration T-1. This observation leads naturally to an incremental forward chaining algorithm where an iteration T, we check a rule only if its premise includes a conjunct PI that unifies with a fact PI newly inferred at iteration T-1. The rule matching steps then fixes PI to match with PI but allows the other conjunct of the rule to match with fact from any previous iteration. Now this algorithm generates exactly the same fact at each iteration of the algorithm of the previous figure. Now typically only a small fraction of the rules in the knowledge base are actually triggered by the addition of a given fact. This means that a great deal of redundant work is done in repeatedly constructing a partial matches that have some unsatisfied premises. Our CRAM example is rather too small to show this effectively, But notice that the partial match is constructed on the first iteration between the rule American X, disjunction weapon Y, disjunction cell, disjunction hostile implies criminal X, and the fact American West. So this example we have seen previously also. Now the next point is backward chaining. Now we describe the basic algorithm and then we describe how it is used in logic programming. Now we talk about the backward chaining. We describe the basic algorithm, then we describe how it is used in logic programming, which is the most widely used form of automated reasoning. Now the first point is backward chaining algorithm, how this algorithm is going to work. Now backward chaining algorithm is a kind of AND OR search, the OR part because the goal query can be proved by any rule in the knowledge base, and AND part because all the conjunct in the LHS of a alpha clause can be proved. So FALL BC OR works by fetching all clauses that might unify with the goal, standardizing the variables in the clause to be brand new variables. And then if the RHS of the clause, that is right hand side of the clause, does indeed with unify with the goal, proving every conjunct in the LHS using FALL BC AND. That function in turn works by proving each of the conjunct, in turn keeping track of accumulated substitution as we go. Backward chaining is clearly a depth first search algorithm. This means that its space requirements are linear in the size of the proof. It also means that backward chaining suffers from problems with repeated states and incompleteness. So the function FALL BC ask KB query returns a generator of substitution. Now it is going to return FALL BC or KB, that is knowledge base and query, that are the inputs. What will be the generator function? So generator function is going to give our ELF a substitution. So this is a simple backward chaining algorithm for the first order knowledge bases. Now this will be representation for the criminal West, American West, weapons Y, cells. So this is the proof tree constructed by backward chaining to prove that West is a criminal. The tree should be read depth first, left to the right to prove criminal West. We have to prove four conjunct below it. Some of these are in the knowledge base and others require further backward chaining. Binding for each successful unification are shown in the next to the corresponding sub-goal. Note that once one sub-goal is conjunction succeeds, a substitution is applied to subsequent sub-goals. Now the next point we are talking about, that's logic programming. Now what is the logic? That whenever we want to solve any kind of problem, we have to apply certain kind of things so that the output will be generated. So that is the logic. And the algorithm is nothing but logic plus the control, it is called as logic. Sorry, the logic plus algorithm is called as algorithm. Now Prolog, it is a most widely used logic programming language. It is used primarily as a rapid prototyping language and for symbol manipulation tasks such as writing compilers, parsing natural language. Many expert systems have been written in Prolog for legal, medical, financial and other domains. So this question may be asked, which language is mostly used for logical programming? That will be a Prolog. Prolog programming are sets of definite clauses written in a notation somewhat different from standard first order logic. Prolog uses uppercase letters for variables and lowercase for constants, the opposite of our convention for logic. The commas separate conjunct in a clause and the clauses written backward from what we are used to. Instead of A, disjunction B implies C. Now these are the notations. E or L denotes a list whose first element is E and whose rest is L. Here is a Prolog program for appending X, Y, Z, which succeeds if list Z is the result of appending list X and Y. So this kind of product languages which are used for logical programming, and these are kind of syntaxes. Now, next point is efficient implementation of logic programs. First, our implementation had to explicitly manage the iteration over a possible result generated by each of the sub functions. Prolog interpreters have a global data structure, a stack of choice points to keep track of the multiple possibilities that we consider in fall BCR. This global stack is more efficient and it makes debugging easier because the debugger can move up and down the stack. Second, our simple implementation of fall BCRs spends a good deal of time generating substitutions. Instead of explicitly constructing substitution, Prolog has a logic variables that remember their current binding. At any point in time, every variable in the program either is bound or either is unbound or is bound to some value. Together, these variables and the values implicitly define the substitution for the current brand of the proof. Extending the path can only add new variables variable binding, because an attempt to add a different binding for an already bound variable result in a failure of unification. When a path in the search fails, Prolog will back up to a previous choice point, and then it might have to unbind some variables. This is done by keeping track of all variables that have been bound in a stack called the trail. Now this is the function or the procedure append, where ax, y, az and continuation, these are the inputs, and a global trail pointer, that will be the function we are calling, and it is going to implies tail. This is the pseudocode representing the result of compiling the append predicate. The function new variable returns a new variable distinct from all other variables used so far. The procedure call continuation continues execution with unified specified continuation. Now the next point is redundant inference and infinite loops. Consider the following logic program that decides if a path exists between two points in a directed graph. So the path xy link xy, path xz path xy link xz. If we put two clauses in the order path xz path xy link yz path xz link xz, then the Prolog follows the infinite path shown in figure 9.10b. Prolog is therefore incomplete as a theorem prover for a definite clauses, even for data log programs, as this example shows, because for some knowledge bases it fails to prove sentences that are entailed. Notice that forward chaining does not suffer from this problem. Once path A and B, path B, C, path A, C are inferred, forward chaining halts. Depth first backward chaining also has problem with redundant computation. For example, when finding a path from A1 to J4 in figure next, Prolog performs 877 inferences, most of which involves binding all possible path to node from which the goal is unreachable. The total amount of inference can be exponential in the number of ground facts that are generated. If we apply forward chaining instead, at most of the 2n path xy fact can be generated linking n nodes. So this kind of a dynamic programming where the solutions to a sub problems are constructed incrementally from those of a smaller. So the solutions can be dynamic because it's a dynamic programming. Now this is the diagram we have discussed previous. Finding a path from A to C can lead a Prolog into an infinite loop. Now the next diagram, that is B, it is a graph in which each node is connected to two random successors. So it can be any two random successor in the next layer. Now finding a path from A1 to J4 requires 877 inferences. So, and this is diagram representing for proof that a path exists from A to C. Infinite proof tree generated when a clause are in the wrong order. Now the next point is database semantic of prologue. Consider the following prologue assertions about some course offering. Now course CS101, course CS102, course CS106, course EE101. Under the unique names of assumption, CS and EE are different as are 101, 2 and 106. So this means that there are four distinct courses. Under the closed world assumption, there are no other courses. So there are exactly four courses. But if these were assertions in the FOL rather than in prologue, then all we could say is that there are somewhere between 1 and infinity courses. That's because the assertions in FOL do not deny the possibility that other unmentioned courses are also offered, nor do they say that the courses mentioned are different from each other. If we wanted to translate the equation of the above in FOL, we can write like this. The course D, comma N is going to imply like this. Now this is called as completion of equation. It expressed in a FOL, the idea is that there are at most four courses. To express in FOL the idea that there are at least four courses, we need to write the complete of the equality predicate. The completion is useful for understanding database semantic and for practical purposes. If your problem can be described with a database semantic, it is more efficient to reason with prologue or some other database semantic system rather than translating into FOL and reasoning into a full FOL theorem prover. Now the next point is constraint logic programming. Now consider the following example. We define a triangle XYZ as a predicate that holds if the three arguments are numbers that satisfy the triangle inequality. Now triangle and the coordinates are XYZ. X is greater than 0, Y is greater than 0, Z is greater than 0. Again X plus Y is equal to Z, Y plus Z is equal to X and X plus Z is equal to Y. If we ask prologue the query triangle 3, 4, 5, it succeeds. On the other hand, if we ask triangle 3, 4 and Z, no solution will be found because the sub goal Z is greater than or equal to 0 cannot be handled by a prologue. We can't compare an unbound value to 0. Now the constraint logic programming, that is CLP, allows the variables to be constrained rather than bound. A CLP solution is the most specific set of constraints on the query variable that can be derived from the knowledge base. For example, the solution to the triangle 3, 4 and Z query is a constraint 7 is greater than equal to Z is greater than equal to 1. Standard logic programs are just a special case of CLP in which the solution constraints must be equality constraint, that is bindings. The CLP system incorporates various constraint solving algorithms for the constraints allowing in the language. For example, a system that allows linear inequalities on real valued variables might include a linear programming algorithm for solving those constraints. The CLP system also adopts a much more flexible approach to solving standard logic programming queries. Now the next point, that is resolution. The last of our three families of logical system is based on the resolution. Now the first point is conjective normal form for the first order logic. As in the proportional case, the first order resolution requires that sentence can be conjective. Now the normal form, that is conjective normal form, the conjunction of clauses where each clause is a disjunction of literals. Literals can contain variables which are assumed to be universally quantified. For example, sentence is universally qualified X, American X, disjunction weapons Y, disjunction cell XYZ, disjunction hostile X, it implies to criminal. So this is the indication how the first order logic is going to be applied. Now the conjunction normal form will be negation of American X, you know, this is the conjunction again negation of weapon by. So like this we can apply the conjectives. Now every sentence of the first order logic can be converted into an inferentially equivalent to CNF sentence. In particular, CNF sentence will be unsatisfied just when the original sentence is unsatisfied. So we have a basis for doing proofs for contradiction on the CNF. Now the principal difference arises from the need to eliminate essential qualifiers. We illustrate the procedure for translating the sentence, "Everyone who loves all animals is loved by someone," or universal qualifier. Now this will be the statement. Now eliminate implication. Now this will be the general formulas. Move negation inwards. In addition to the usual rules for negated conjectives, we need rules for negated quantifiers. So negation of universal qualifier XP becomes now like this. Now here how the universal quantifier in the premise of the implication has become an essential quantifier. Sentence now reads, "Either there is some animal that X doesn't love or someone loves X." Clearly the meaning of the original sentence has been preserved. Next point is standardized variables. Now these are the variables which use the same variables named twice. Change the name of one of the variable. This avoids the confusion later when we drop the quantifiers. So here we are just going to change the name of the variable. Now columnize. Now columnization is a process of removing essential quantifiers by elimination of translate, where A is constant. We can't apply essential instantiation to our sentence above because it doesn't match the pattern. Now only parts of the sentence that match the pattern. We blindly apply the rule to the two matching parts. We get the equation like this. Now this expression which has a wrong meaning entirely, it says that everyone either fails to love a particular animal A or is loved by someone particular entity B. In fact, our original sentence allows each sentence to fail to love a different animal or to be loved by a different person. Now when we see the equation, F and G are the slalom functions, column functions. The general rule is that the argument of the column function are all the universally quantified variables in which scope is essential quantifier appears. So this was the end of this chapter. If you have any doubts, you can put on the comments. Thank you.